Hi, I'm Ganna Pogrebna. I'm a professor of business analytics and data science. And today I'm going to talk about behavioral aspects of artificial intelligence. But before we go into the talk, I want to say that this talk was supposed to be delivered by my colleague Mark Skilton. Unfortunately, Mark couldn't deliver this talk because he passed away after a short but brave battle with cancer. So I'm doing this this talk to replace what he would have said about behavioral aspects of artificial intelligence. So my opinion does not necessarily coincide with his. He was a friend of mine and a colleague of mine. And this is a terrible loss for all of us. And we are really all shocked that this happened so quickly. So what I want to say is that Mark's family currently collecting money for collecting donations for cancer research, and if you can donate, there will be a link underneath this video. So please do support Mark's family if you're watching this presentation. Every little donation will make a huge difference. So please do help if you can. So now on to behavioral aspects of AI. So let's look at this issue a little bit more closely. Like I said, so if you want to help with the course, the crowdfunding link is this one, and I'm going to also ask the organizers to provide the link underneath this video. So Mark was actually a professor of practice at Warwick Business School, so please do support this course, and please also leave some tributes. If you have known Mark, it means a lot to his family to read these tributes if you want to remember him. Okay, so behavioral aspects of AI. So if we look at basically AI-driven business models, so AI-driven algorithms, we often see that it's functionality over ergonomics. So we have a lot of very complicated algorithms that try to basically work with human behavior, either alongside human behavior or change human behavior. But essentially, if we look at artificial intelligence, it's very difficult to define it. So I personally, you know, was trying to write an article with several co-authors, and we were trying to define artificial intelligence, and we decided that we couldn't do that because there are so many definitions, so many different approaches to artificial intelligence. So instead, we decided to just look at algorithms, you know, what type of algorithms we have in terms of automated and autonomous algorithms. So essentially, if we look at algorithms, we have the following automated algorithms. We have automatic and autonomous. So automatic algorithms are something that work with you know, purpose that is defined by the human, and then basically every single function of this algorithm is also defined by the human. So for example, a coffee machine, like I have right here. So a coffee machine just makes you pre-programmed coffee. It could be either, you know, I don't know, espresso, americano. So you just press the button and your drink is made, right? So this is something that is automatic. So you, as a designer, as a human, you define not only its purpose, but also how it gets to the purpose. You define how much coffee and how much milk, how much sugar or no sugar should go into each drink. And essentially, you know, everything is predefined. Unless the machine knows this definition, it will not make you a drink, right? And then we have autonomous algorithms. So autonomous algorithms can be split into autotelenomic and teleologic. Autotelenomic algorithms essentially look at at a particular problem that is posed by the human. So the human says, well, I want, for example, if we take a driverless car like I have right here, or even simpler, you might have a vacuum cleaner. An automatic vacuum cleaner in your home. So normally you just tell this vacuum cleaner to clean the area. And then the machine or the algorithm is trying to find the most efficient way to get from point A to point B, if this is an autonomous vehicle, or if this is an automated vacuum cleaner, it tries to find the best way around your apartment to make the least number of moves to clean the entire apartment, right? So in a sense, it basically cannot define its own purpose. This algorithm cannot define its own purpose, but it can define the steps that would allow the algorithm to, you know, to get to the purpose. So the purpose is, for example, to clean the room, and the algorithm would define how it gets there. And then we have teleologic machines. So teleologic machines do not actually exist in practice. They only exist in theory. And usually this is how the majority of people imagine artificial intelligence. So they imagine some sort of Terminator, like I have here, or Sunny. This is another robot from a film. So this is kind of a machine that can not only identify each step in order to get to a purpose, but also can define its own purpose, right? So it can define, oh, I want to do this, and then it could define the steps to get there. So obviously, when we talk about autotelenomic algorithms, we talk about machine learning algorithms, deep learning algorithms, algorithms that already exist. Like I said, teleologic machines, we are not there. I don't think we will be there in near future. But this is kind of something that the humanity is constantly thinking about. And, you know, we even have objects of culture that represent this type of machines, but we don't have them yet. So, you know, when we talk about behavioral aspects of artificial intelligence, we often need to think about how humans interact with algorithms. And, you know, in terms of data-driven algorithms and data-driven business models that we have in different areas, it's very often that we have a problem with humans, right? So you can write a perfect algorithm, like, for example, you know, you can write a perfect algorithm for a driverless car, but then you have a human being. And the human interacts with this particular algorithm. And even if the algorithm is great, you know, human intervention may change everything. So here I have a quote from the Matrix movie where Agent Smith basically says, well, you know, we created this perfect matrix, but then we have humans, and humans basically interact with this matrix and make everything worse. So in order to illustrate various behavioral aspects of artificial intelligence, I particularly want to talk about the future of work, because I think this is one of the main issues. So the main issue currently is how we as humans are going to interact with machines and how we are going to live in synergy and in harmony with these machines. So, you know, basically, one of the main questions of behavioral aspects of artificial intelligence is finding the balance between human talent and automation. So you need to understand how basically human beings are going to fit into automated world. So in here we have two aspects of a problem. We have employer's problem and we have employee's problem. And basically, when we look at the employer's problem, employer basically normally thinks, what are the effects on my business model? So how do we, you know, if I introduce more automation, if I have more machines as a business owner, how is it going to affect my business? And the employee basically is trying to consider the employability, right? But both of these sides, both employers and employees, are thinking what skills will be needed in one 5, 10, 20 years time. So, for example, let's not go very far. This year we had a big problem with coronavirus. And, you know, the skills, for example, that were needed this year were quite different from the skills that were needed in 2019, right? And some of the skills, so some people could not do their work, at least they couldn't do their work in the normal way. And this is where behavioral science intervenes, and behavioral science can actually help to adapt. Well, let me give you a very specific example. As you know, a lot of hairdressers found themselves in a difficult situation as a result of coronavirus. And basically, there is a project at the University of Birmingham that was conducted using kind of this idea of behavioral change and technology and using technology. So an alumni of University of Birmingham actually designed a website where you could go and you can be matched with a hairdresser who would then give you live instructions when you are trying to cut hair, like cut your friend's hair, for example. So this website was hugely successful because it implemented several aspects of very, very good behavioral science. So first of all, it considered both the human aspects and the technology aspect. It considered the need to engage and to basically allow the affiliation that normally would not have a digital representation, so hairdressers could actually go online and provide instructions. But also there was an economic aspect because people were paying, right? They were paying for a particular service, so this advice, and that allowed hairdressers to actually, you know, not go bankrupt, not go into financial hardship, or essentially the hairdressers who engaged with this tool. So this is an example of how you could basically implement behavioral design, behavioral science in practice and actually make a difference for a large number of people. So in particular, in people of a particular occupation or profession. Another important question that we face when we think about behavioral aspects of artificial intelligence is, can machines replace humans? And here I basically have written the occupations that are really in high risk occupations. So we have in legal services, these are data entry people, legal discovery and contracting employees. We know that algorithms have already outperformed many functions of these employees. So what it means is that they would need urgent behavioral change policies that would allow them to retrain, potentially get different types of skills that they would need in the future in order to adapt to the current situation. In medical services, you probably know this is a textbook example. These are radiologists. So radiology, essentially, in radiology, big progress was made with deep learning, and deep learning models already outperform radiologists. So the reason why we still have humans doing radiology is legal reasons, because, you know, machines do not really have responsibility, you know, legally. But essentially, you know, in terms of diagnosing, deep learning algorithms are used as decision support systems for radiologists and actually are quite accurate. Journalists, researchers and reporters are in high risk because of automation and various algorithms that we currently have that in some areas we even have algorithms that can write articles for journalists. So basically they're replaced with algorithms. Automotive services, obviously, drivers. I have already given an example in this talk of driverless cars. So this is where we have kind of human operator instead of a driver. So drivers are definitely at risk. Food industry, yeah, chefs. As you know, there is a lot of automation in kitchen and cuisine. You know, it's hard to tell to what extent, you know, chefs are actually in immediate danger, but, you know, there is definitely a lot of automation in this industry. Finance, definitely analysts are under risk in high-risk occupation because there are algorithmic developments in many areas of finance where analysts might basically be not needed anymore. Customer services and personalized assistance. Well, you probably know for yourself that a few years ago you would go to a supermarket, you would always interact with a human being. Now there are many automated checkouts, so you interact with a machine. So sure enough, you normally have kind of one human or two human beings supervising the area with machines, but essentially there is a lot of automation, and that has changed many people's lives. Construction, dexterity tasks are being replaced in construction. So construction is another important industry for automation, and you know, many people are in high risk. Music, you know, composers are in high risk. Again, we have music that is written by artificial intelligent agents. I'm not saying that this music is as good as music written by a human being, but what I'm saying is it could be preferred by some companies for several reasons. For example, you know, if they believe that algorithm is cheaper, they might kind of get music, like background music, for example, for the website from an algorithmic composer rather than a human composer. So we need to decide what to do with human composers. And then creative industry. So we have script writers where, you know, currently we have artificial intelligence writing scripts. So definitely script writers are in high risk occupation. So all these occupations are in high risk. And you know, if we look at the future, there were basically two reports. One of them is optimistic, another one is pessimistic. The optimistic one is the OECD report that basically predicted, basically looked at how the occupations are going to change. And then there is a pessimistic report from the University of Oxford. So if we look at the OECD report, then the percentage of people affected, for example, in US and the UK was 10 and 12% respectively. If we look at the Oxford report, then 47% in the US and 35% in the UK are going to be affected. So, you know, there is a huge difference in these numbers. And the main problem with these reports is that they do not consider the jobs that will be created by artificial intelligence. So they kind of just look at current jobs and they make assumptions about what part of automation might actually put particular types of jobs at risk. So that's something that we always have to keep at the back of our mind. And where the behavioral science comes in is when we actually ask people about the perceptions of risk of their own job, then they normally, so this is a very interesting stats. So according to different studies, also studies that we have done in my lab, you know, the majority of people believe that, you know, the market and job market will definitely be affected by artificial intelligence. But when we ask people, do you think your job is going to be affected? Then only between 9% and 23% in the US says that it will, and between 3% and 15% people in the UK say that it will. So people kind of think that, yes, it will happen, but it's not going to happen to me. Well, the employers are a lot more kind of rational in that regard, but still, you know, we have this mismatch between beliefs and the actual situation. Okay, so the big problem that we actually observe on behavioral side with artificial intelligence is illusion of control. We essentially always, as humans, believe that we do not depend that much on technology, but we are dependent, we are heavily dependent on technology. And the recent, again, recent coronavirus crisis showed that very, very vividly, when essentially even if you thought that you could do without technology currently, you know, you cannot do anything pretty much, you know, unless you are prepared to stay at home and not... you know, basically, unless you are prepared to stay at home completely isolated and do not have any interaction with the outside world, you know that you need to use some technology. And here I basically have this is one of my favorite moments from the Matrix movie, when the counselor is asking Neo, you know, what do you think is control? And Neo says, well, look at these machines. If we, these machines are helping us, you know, to have electricity or water, and if we wanted to, we would shut them down. And the counselor said, okay, yeah, sure, that's true, but imagine what would happen if we shut them down. We probably will all die. So we depend on these machines, and these machines depend on us. And this is the kind of thing that we need to remember when we consider behavioral aspects of artificial intelligence, that we have a huge dependency on machines, but people normally underestimate this dependency and they have this illusion of control. They believe that they control the situation and in fact they don't. Another important behavioral aspect of artificial intelligence, again, in application to work that we are considering in this talk, is of course human resource management using artificial intelligence. And here we have a two-sided problem. On the one hand, of course, employers want to collect more data and understand what drives productivity, what drives change, what drives innovation in organizations. But at the same time, we have problems with employee surveillance. And here we have various issues that, you know, are completely, are very, very important, but sometimes I think they are kind of this bollocks du jour type of behavioral change projects. For example, we have a big issue with job and work surveillance in some places where algorithms even track people's toilet time, which is completely ridiculous. And, you know, obviously, you know, it doesn't add much to understanding of productivity, and at the same time, it's micromanaging employees such that they mistrust organizations. So these are very, very interesting questions for behavioral science. Also, we have things like this, where, you know, many employers actually now implement digital interviews or AI interviews, where you're basically, before you go, for example, when you send your CV, but before you go to a human committee, you would be pre-interviewed by the algorithm. There are a lot of weird aspects of this. Not only you are recording yourself, but also you're receiving instructions and questions from a machine, and you do understand that this is a machine. So, you know, being in this situation is not very natural for a human being, and obviously has a lot of, you know, behavioral implications that we all need to deal with in when we consider human behavior and artificial intelligence. Another interesting aspect of behavioral aspect of artificial intelligence concerns the machines themselves. So how good are digital employees? So we know that some of the technology that we have on the market is sold as being an intelligent assistant. So for example, Siri is often sold as an intelligent assistant. However, when, you know, Siri makes mistakes, and sometimes it does, normally, you know, we have statements from the development company, so the development company of Siri is Apple, that says that, oh, we didn't engineer this thing to be a trivial pursuit, so we didn't actually, you know, engineer it to be better than the human. But, you know, so that's a big, big behavioral problem as well, because, you know, we need to understand not only whether humans could be replaced, but how well the algorithms are replacing some of the human functions. Because, you know, you can also imagine that there could be positive aspects of this positive aspects of replacement, because you could, for example, free up imagine that all routine tasks that you do, like data collection, you know, that takes a lot of time, data systematization, data cleansing. Imagine that all of this could be done for you by an artificial intelligence algorithm. That would be really great, right? Because that would give you some time to do more creative work. So there are basically positive aspects of it, but if we don't know how good these algorithms actually are, we cannot design the systems to implement them. And that's, again, where the behavioral science would play a major role in the next few years. I also want to touch on human perceptions. So this is, for example, my dog. He is an experimentalist dog, so he has this data chip right here. So this is like Fitbit only for dogs. It's called Fitbark. So my dog passed away several years ago, but I still have data, you know, generated by this sensor that he used to wear, as any experimentalist dog, I guess. So and this is kind of the type of data that I would know. So I know all the data about his activity. So much like this movie with Arnold Schwarzenegger, where you had Repet, where you could basically replicate your pet if your pet died. So you could, you know, I could potentially replicate, I can basically make a digital twin of my dog. It will completely repeat the behavior of my dog. However, where the problem lies is that I'm not going to interact with this new digital dog in the same way that I interacted with my actual dog, right? Because I will realize that that's not the same. And again, this is a big, big important problem for behavioral science. You know, how do we make these perceptions? Basically, to what extent can we smooth these perceptions in terms of, you know, what people actually think about algorithms and how they interact with algorithms? So, for example, again, you know, I'm the kind of person that, you know, when I call a bank, for example, I would press whatever button there is to get to a human being. Whereas my sister, who is 7 years younger than me, she's quite happy to talk to an algorithm, to talk to a chatbot. So, and we will see the shift in behavior in that regard. So we will see that people will first recognize bots more readily, so they will be able to interact with them better. And perhaps we will see the behavior shifting from preferring an individual in some cases to preferring a machine. I, for example, know that some of my friends prefer to interact with a digital cashier in a supermarket rather than a human cashier. So for a number of contexts, we will have the preferences shifted very quickly. For other contexts, like, for example, you know, a job interview or, you know, a doctor's advice, you know, you probably cannot imagine that the machines will overtake very soon. So what does it all tell us in terms of, you know, future skills? So we have basically, again, employee and employee. And we used to think that kind of, you know, we had this natural sciences at the top, humanities and social sciences kind of tagging along in terms of this hierarchy of skills. And we need creativity. We used to think that we need creativity. But actually, you know, we know now that artificial intelligence can do a lot of creative things. So instead of creativity, we actually need to think about transferability. So we need to have transferable skills so that if we cannot do one particular task within an organization, we can do another task. And in fact, you know, if you think about the potential risks, you know, what type of professions are at risk, you know, if you you are doing something that you can describe in every little detail, so you can describe every single task very precisely of what it is that you're doing every day, then you are at risk and you need to be thinking about potentially how to make your skills more transferable so you can do other things. So in terms of, you know, how can we alleviate these risks, how can we prepare people for the future? Well, one thing is to actually work with risk, right, and to try to understand risks. So for, you know, for various employers, what employers can do is they can design this risk mapping of the organization and to understand which occupations are likely to be at risk, and they can start preparing people for basically taking up a completely different task, or, you know, basically train them in these transferable skills early. So no one loses their job, but instead, you know, you have algorithms that overtake some routine tasks, and you have humans who will be doing more complex, more analytical work in organizations. So this is a quote from my dad, and he said to me once that an educated person is someone who can take any book and make sense of it, and I think it perfectly describes transferability. So this is a skill that we all need to train. We basically need to think how we're going to adapt to a changing environment. And this year we saw an example of a changing environment. This was coronavirus, and we all saw how quickly we needed to change. And what I want to say at the end of this talk is that coronavirus is not actually an inhibitor. There are a lot of memes on the web saying that, you know, we all thought that, you know, the digital transformation is going to change the world, but now we know it's COVID. Well, COVID, well, whether we believe it or not, it's still a temporary thing. But this temporary thing has a big impact on all aspects of human life, including, you know, economy, including our day-to-day behavior. But essentially what we need to remember is COVID is an accelerator. So what COVID showed is that we need to all transfer to automated world, to the AI-driven world, data-driven world sooner. So we need to think how can we increase automation, and we do not have time to develop this automation. So we actually need to do it very, very quickly. And this is where I think we have a lot of challenges and opportunities for behavioral science. So, what are the takeaways from this talk? So the main takeaway is when we consider behavioral aspects of artificial intelligence, there are of course many, many different domains in which we can consider the impact of artificial intelligence. So I took one specific domain, which was future of work. And we can see how, you know, various behavioral aspects are impacting our interaction with artificial intelligence, particularly, you know, illusion of control, basically perceptions, risk perceptions. What we need to understand is that, you know, we currently live in the world where artificial intelligence change through this industrial revolution 4.0 is going to accelerate. So we will see more automation a lot quicker than we anticipated originally. And we all need to think how we're going to adapt. And this is where behavioral science will play an important role, because we need to understand how to harmonize this relationship between humans and machines. And that can hardly be done without understanding human behavior and machine behavior really well. Thank you very much. And I hope you will enjoy the rest of the talks today. And thanks a lot.